We're talking all things music today. We've got the lovely James Partridge coming on today.
Hello.
Hello. How are you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm good. I've had a long day of lessons and various things going on.
So, for anyone watching, this is going to be a little bit of a different one, because usually the interviewer from Twinkl, either me or Izzy, are finding out about a teacher, finding out about what they do, finding out how they got onto TikTok. This one's a little different, as James and I work together at a school. We were teachers together at the same school, which was, like, it's just the bizarrest thing.
Yeah. I work not as a classroom teacher. For those of you that are watching this that haven't seen my stuff, basically my channel is kind of nostalgic school songs and other musical things and kind of primary school related things. And I teach in different schools, teaching music and things like that.
What got you into, like, on the topic, what got you into teaching? Like, why did you go, oh, do you know what? I want to teach.
Well, the thing is, both of my parents are teachers. And when I was younger, I thought the last thing I'd want to do is be a teacher like my parents. So literally, it was like, whatever I do, I don't care, but I just don't want to be a teacher. So I thought I'd be like, I kind of thought I'd be like a music journalist or something. So then I studied music at university and worked for a music company on like more of the business side of things. So I was working in an office, kind of admin 9 to 5, literally 9 to 5 in an office. And I did that for a couple of years after uni and then realized it's not really for me, that side of things. I really missed kind of, because I had before that played piano for various choirs and worked on singing courses and things like that. And so I started doing more private teaching and got a job at a school in London. And then from that, kind of interviewed for a couple of other schools, including the one that we taught at. And from that, a lot of private teaching came about. So that's kind of how I got into the teaching side of things.
Yeah. Why did you, obviously, like, music was your, like, thing. Did you ever, now that you've done it, would you ever go and teach other lessons? Is there ever a part of you that's like, you know what, I'd love to teach a maths lesson?
I would be a really bad maths teacher. My knowledge of maths is absolutely terrible.
I mean, I thought the same. Yeah. I thought I would be the same, but I have students. I've got one of my old students there and she knows.
Oh, yeah.
You know, I'm sure she'd say I helped her slightly. What's the best gift you've ever received or you've heard of someone receiving?
Well, I mean, I think the best gift I received was a £50 like John Lewis voucher, and love I was that. Completely just like, what? I mean, I don't think it's worth that much, but I was like, are you sure that this is for me? I'm just trying to think if I've been given anything kind of strange.
A teacher that we both know remember at our school was gifted an Apple Watch once.
Really?
The year six teacher, who we both know very well.
Okay.
She was gifted an Apple Watch once, which I remember. That was a story she told me. But one of the most incredible was not, I worked there when I was 30. It was my first teaching job. And it wasn't given to me. It was given to my class teacher when she got married. And all the parents got together and paid for the catering for her wedding.
No way. Wow.
But this was like very, I think one thing that we will say, because we've got quite a few people in here, this was like very inner London.
Sure. Very
posh private school.
Yeah, yeah.
I love one of the gifts that I always keep, and I actually have a folder, and I'm staring at it because I can see it right now, is all of the cards I've ever been like written or made. I think that's quite a nice, like, if you're an ECT or you're thinking about training to be a teacher or working with children, like, in any capacity, have a little, like, folder or a little box where you keep all the things. Because I've got some such lovely cards, particularly, like, if you work in a year group where your kids sit exams. So I've got some really lovely cards from, like, parents whose children's, like, sat exams and things like that. That was, like, I don't know, that was like, that's a really nice one. And sometimes even now I like look back, particularly at our kids from our last school, and I'm like, oh.
I think that is a really nice thing, and it's like, I don't know, you could almost use some of that stuff for references in a way. It's like, I've got this whole folder of
I
cards and
did.
things. Yeah,
It was
really?
one of the things that I was asked at a job interview once was what have your relationships been like with parents? And so
Okay.
I took in, and I knew that was one of my questions,
Yeah.
I took in all of the letters that I'd been sent from parents, particularly like if you've ever had a child with like a stronger like SEN or
Sure.
like something like that. Like it's really handy to like be able to be like, look, I can do this.
Yeah. Well, especially I think some of the pupils that have SENs, I think you need it's such a like a close bond between them, isn't it?
Yeah.
So it can that can be quite tough when that comes apart. Sorry, I just noticed a comment. Someone, Beth, has asked to sing a classic primary school song. So we'll probably get onto that a bit later if you're able to
We
stick around
will.
for a bit.
100%. We're going to actually do. I am going to test my knowledge, but James, I think, is also going to, like, I'm going to try and test James. Though, I was trying to find songs that you'd not done online.
Okay,
I
okay.
couldn't
Yeah.
find any.
I mean, I have done quite a lot now, so.
What's your, speaking of, like, your TikTok,
Sure.
what made you start it? Like, what, was it in lockdown? Was it, what made you go, do you know what? I want to start a TikTok channel.
I tell you what it was. Basically, obviously over COVID, all of us had to kind of adapt to teaching online and working online. Over 2020, I'd done so many online lessons, and by the end of the year, I went and I just like had Christmas off, and I was kind of reflecting on the year that we just had, and thinking, wow, what a crazy year we've had. And I thought, what could I do to kind of make an impact on my pupils or even just anyone else that's watching? So I thought, I had an old YouTube channel that I'd put some like backing tracks on there for singing pupils. And I'd been using that during the COVID singing lessons. So essentially, I'd make the backing tracks and then I'd upload them onto my YouTube channel and then send the link to the pupil beforehand so that they could sing along to it. Because basically, teaching singing online over Zoom is fine, but you kind of have to work with it slightly where you're like a beat, like you're a beat out of time with the pupil on the other side. So you do get used to it, but it's a lot better if they have their own backing track. Anyway, I kind of thought, well, why don't I do a few like singing lesson tips videos? So I made a few videos which were like singing warm-ups and tips like that. And I posted them as YouTube videos, and then a friend of mine said, oh, have you seen this TikTok thing? And well, my flatmate at the time had been on TikTok for a year, and he was just watching like people dancing, and I was like, yeah, I know that app. It's like, I don't know, it's just like people dancing and stuff. And he'd done like a guitar tutorial thing on there. I thought, oh, I should do something similar with mine. And then I did a few kind of tips and hints videos for singing. And then I did a couple, and then I was at home for Easter Sunday last year. And I thought, oh, it'd be good to do something like related to Easter. What are the old Easter hymns we used to sing? So I did a few of those. Just as like a top, I was like, these are five Easter hymns. And then that got loads of comments from people saying, oh yeah, I remember that one, or what about this? And that made me think, oh, what about all the songs we used to sing at school? Because I'd been down the pub with a couple of friends from that I'd been to primary school with, like the only friends that I'd kind of kept from that time. And one of them was getting married, and at the time we were talking about what songs you're gonna have. One More Step Along the World I Go had to be in there. We were like, oh, we have to have Shine Jesus Shine, but his wife vetoed it,
Done
so but
it. Why?
Well, yeah, they only had two hymns actually, but they wanted one traditional and one like more kind of like primary school banger type thing.
Yeah,
So
got.
we did One More Step Along the World I Go, which is the classic.
I love
Anyway, so I was kind of thinking about that conversation. I thought, what are 10 songs that I remember really vividly from
that.
school? And so I just put that together thinking it'd be a bit of an in joke for my friends. And then it just went absolutely nuts, and it got shared by like the Department of Education and on like radio stations and stuff. And then Loose Women did a share of it, and yeah.
What did, because that was like, I remember that's how I found you on TikTok. I was
Oh, really?
scrolling
Right.
in my classroom on my PPA, and I remember James was downstairs teaching a music lesson,
Oh,
and
really?
I was like, I was, when you just scroll through socials, and I was scrolling, scrolling.
Yeah.
And I scrolled past it, and I remember vividly because I screamed for the teacher next door. I was like, ah! I was like, get in now. I was like, you have to see who I've just scrolled past. I was like, that is who I think it is. And she's like, yeah, no, that's definitely Mr. James.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
I remember that was like the funniest thing. And then I sort of forgot about it. And then I saw you on Loose Women. Like, I saw a clip on TikTok on Loose Women. And I feel like you were one of the first people, like, in that, like, teaching, like, the teaching bubble to be, like, put onto... What was, like, being on mainstream media? Like, how did that... Did you get comments from kids or teachers or parents? Or was it just a bit, like... Of like a hush-hush, like what?
Well, the kind of bizarre thing about it was I had the morning off that day and I got a text from a friend saying, are you going to be on TV? And I said, no, why, what? Like, what? And he said, oh yeah, my mum's watching Loose Women. And at the beginning of the show, they said, at the end of the show, stick around because we're going to be going through our top 10 assembly bangers. And he said, oh, that's similar to your video. Mm. And I thought, And so I kind of found it online. I was watching it kind of like from the start of the show. And then I kind of skipped through it after it aired. And at first I was thinking, I think someone's probably seen my video and then thought, oh, that's a good idea for like a little segment at the end of the show. And then
and then
they would just talk about it basically, or just talk about their own, which is fine. You know, I wouldn't have been that bothered. It's not like I haven't copyrighted the idea or anything. But then they literally reacted to the TikTok video live for about 10 minutes. And I kind of filmed some of it, but I didn't actually post the whole thing, but, they reacted to them and they knew probably actually half, if that, of them.
Because I got really upset because they didn't know one of them. And I was like, what's wrong with you?
I mean, they didn't even really know some of the well-known ones, like This Little Lies of Mine and stuff like that, you know.
When there was only one of them that knew it, I was like, where have you been? Like,
I know,
What did other teachers, or like, how did you tell SLTs at your school? When your social media, because obviously that, like, blew your account up.
Yeah.
Did you, like, tell... teachers did pupils find you, like what happened?
It's kind of been a bit of a trickle effect because I've not actively been going out telling people about it, so I think well, if people come across it, that's fine. And the funny thing is, even though I've been doing TikTok since last March, I think I set it up, it's been kind of a very slow process of people saying, oh, I saw you're on social media, kind of thing. So I literally had on Monday in the staff room at one of the schools I teach in, I sat down and the teacher next to me said, oh, I was scrolling on TikTok the other day and I saw, and this is someone that I actually hadn't really spoken to much before, and she said, oh yeah, you came up on my TikTok feed the other day. And then someone else said, oh yeah, I saw you on there as well.
I remember, so... this is like an inside, like the inside scoop, at our school, I was the person that outed you to our head teacher by complete accident, because for pupils that are in this or like other teachers, our head teacher, even though she was really young, she did not have, like, she had no social media. I swear, like quite a few of the deputies as well, they were like not on social media. They didn't have it. Maybe it was like a Facebook account and that was it. And I had a TikTok account purely to just, I was not doing anything with it. It was more a case of, I was sometimes filming my days as a teacher. So I was like, that'll be fun to look back on when I'm like old and weary. And I remember, so the students, and they are in this chat because I've seen them, found me on social media and posted and kept sharing it amongst like group chats, and my fiance like nannies for one of the families, so he like had a little bit of an inside scoop, and so it was like I knew that like they'd found me. And so I went to the head teacher, was like, just to like, you know, the kids have found me on social media, but like I've not responded or anything. She's like, oh, that's fine, we don't, like, it's fine, it doesn't matter. And I was like, yeah, no, it's like, it's so annoying. I was like, but I don't know even how they found me. I was like, you know, like, if I was like Mr. James big, I'd understand, but like I've only got like 2,000 followers. And she was like, oh, Mr. James has a a social media. I was like, oh no. I was like,
Yeah.
yeah.
I suppose it is quite a niche though, isn't it? Primary school kind of teaching and life there. And I'm sure the algorithm works by where you're located and things like that.
100%. But that
But
was so
yeah,
funny.
I mean, we could have like a whole conversation about social media in general and schools, because it is quite a big thing. And actually, obviously, most pupils are on social media in some form. Not necessarily the youngest ones, obviously, but even from kind of year four upwards, I've found
Yeah.
people were on TikTok, and even though you're supposed to be 13, etc. I'm not calling anyone out that's in the chat, but anyway, but yeah, so I've just started teaching at a new school actually as of a couple of weeks ago, and part of the contract is you have to not interact with pupils on social media.
Yeah.
And so a couple of them had said to me actually earlier this week, "Oh, I saw you on social media." And I said, "Well," I just said, "Oh yeah, that's great." I didn't really kind of get into it,
Yeah.
but it'll just be one of those things where they have to be aware that someone that's teaching in a school can't really engage with a pupil
Yeah.
that's kind of commenting and things like
I think as well, it's now more normal for like it's become
that.
more normal. Like when I was at school, or even when I was training, like teachers didn't have social media. But I think with TikTok and like Instagram, like I think it's that teachers have accounts because one of the great places, like I as a teacher found so many of my like ideas through social media as a teacher. And so I think actually now it's so normal to have a teaching account on something, whether you use it and film videos or just use it to gain ideas yourself. I think so because it's now more normal, schools are more not relaxed on it, but like you see a lot more, a load more teachers like posting videos whilst they're at school, like videoing in their classrooms. Like we were allowed to do that, like completely. It was never like as long as the children weren't in it, like it was absolutely fine. I think it's nice. It makes teachers like a bit more relatable because I think sometimes they used to be that old-fashioned thing of teachers don't leave school, they just stay at school, they live
Yeah,
there.
it's kind of a slightly tricky boundary to cross, isn't it? Because I remember talking, my dad was a teacher for about 35 years, and he always kind of said that he never wanted to be a friend to the students, but be someone that they could approach and obviously talk to about things. But never, you know, the students' friends. And this is in a secondary school, so even a lot of the sixth form pupils who would be quite friendly. And especially if you're doing school trips and things like that, they might get quite close to you. You just have to still have that boundary, I suppose.
Yeah, I think as long as you have that boundary, we've spoken about it before with one of the teacher fun in year five. I had a really long conversation about because I think particularly as the children get older, you can see like more and more personality. And I think because I usually teach the older ones as well, that's just the year groups that I really like click with. And so it is a difficult boundary, but if you lay that boundary out right, you then end up having like this really lovely like relationship like with your students, and like they know your like your life, and it's like it's quite nice really. And I think it makes it just like teaching more personal, like personal.
And I think especially as a music teacher and a peripatetic visiting music teacher, talking about what I do is actually can actually be part of the lesson really, because if someone is interested in becoming a singer or a musician or anything like that, I can say, look, well, or a piano player or whatever. Say I sit down and not necessarily practice scales every single day, but I test myself in different ways, and then I can put that into practice when I do my gigging or whatever, or picking up chords and things like that to figure out songs. So I think, especially with music teaching, it is quite nice for the students to hear what you have done and what route you went down, especially with the older ones as well. Because I've got a couple of pupils that are in year 11 are thinking of teaching, sorry, thinking of going to drama school and things like that, or doing some kind of studying of music, and so I can then give them a bit of advice based on my own experience as well.
I remember because I trained as even though I've taught maths, all my like my favourite subject to teach is maths. I trained as a music specialist teacher, and we there were out of like I went to a specialist university for trainee primary school teachers, And I, in music specialism, out of like 400 people in that year group, there were six of us that
Really?
chose music. Do you think it's like, what do you think it is? Because I know it's one of those subjects that teachers despise teaching, and
Really?
I
Okay,
don't get
yeah.
it. But it, what, like, what are your opinions on it? Like, is it that, do you think it's like a confidence thing? Like, I don't know. Like, it's one of those, it's really interesting because I love teaching music. I think
Yeah.
it's so much fun.
I think it is, it's a tricky thing, especially if you're not 100% confident with music, because you're almost starting on the back foot slightly, because a lot of the pupils will see a music lesson with someone that isn't necessarily their head of music or whatever. They might see it as a chance to muck about or just bang a few drums or whatever, you know, they see it as a bit of downtime. And I think being able to kind of harness that energy and put it into something creative or productive or kind of historical. And I think, yeah, I think it is hard to know which route to go down, because there are lots of different ways that you can obviously do a music lesson in a classroom, because you can go down more of the kind of tactile route of having the sticks in your hand and knocking them together and, you know, playing xylophones and or making up songs or whatever, or going down the route of this is a crotchet, this is a minim, you know, going more for the kind of theoretical side. So I guess maybe that is hard, because there's lots of different ways to approach it, and there is the big kind of dangerous pitfall of like it could go kind of descend into chaos and carnage. So maybe that could be why. But I realized also I didn't actually answer your question before about if I had to teach a
Oh yeah, I did ask that. I'm an
subject.
awful influencer. I'm not that. I what did I mean, interviewer.
I think I would probably actually want to teach English or history.
Would you?
So those were my three A levels were English, history, and music. And actually, history was by far my best. Music wasn't even my best A level, which is something that I've told pupils before. Say, actually, GCSE and A levels, music was not my best grade, and
And here you are.
History was actually my best subject, so that I think probably it would be history if I was to teach something else.
And I like the topic teaching. I think you can get like really into it, like history, geography, all of that fun stuff. I could never teach, like, it's awful, but as a primary school teacher, I cannot teach English to save
Oh,
my
really?
life. That was one good thing about our school, and we were lucky. When I started and I got the interview, and I remember it was asked as if it was like okay. They were like, oh, also the year six teacher, she actually teaches English for year five and six at the moment. So would you be able to teach maths? I was like, yes,
Yeah.
absolutely, 100%.
Oh,
So it worked out really nicely. But I was what's oh, what's one of Elodie? Sing Miss Molly rap song? No. Elodie, as simple as that. No. That's all I have to say. I'm not your teacher anymore. So therefore, no. Because
Do
Elodie.
we need a moderator in the chat to kind of to
Yeah, I
answer
know.
questions?
Yeah, no, I think it's one of the things that, and actually, Elodie, I'm happy you've asked this question. One of the things I really liked as a teacher was bringing you, I think teaching music in a classroom can be really daunting. As exactly what you were saying, it's like the idea that everything can go wrong quite easily. But also, I remember we had a lecture when we were at uni about singing assemblies, which
Oh,
obviously is
really?
something like you are like,
Okay.
you just know. But that was one thing, even as someone who would happily perform in front of all of my students in an elf costume, which I'd done many a time, or you know, been an absolute like with a microphone, you know, like being an absolute crazy person. The one thing that scared me to death was singing assemblies and having to lead
Really?
them.
Oh,
And I think
yeah.
that's like, and for someone who is very confident with music and know music, did it all my life, did it for GCSE, did it for A level. I think it's like, and I think that's a quite a common teacher fear. What would be your top tip for leading a, like, if you're not a singer, if you don't feel confident in singing, but having to lead a singing lesson, particularly this time of year, because we're about to hit the Christmas period.
Sure. Well, I mean, there's lots of kind of resources online as well to use for backing tracks. If you're a teacher that isn't a singing teacher, or you don't play the piano or anything, I seem to remember you having like videos on the screen on the whiteboard with lyrics and things that you can sing along to. And I think having a bit of a base from the music lessons can help in terms of like if they vaguely know how to sing in tune, that is useful. But no, I think just knowing the tunes that you're trying to teach as well as possible, and being confident in that, and breaking it down into phrases as well. So, if you've got a sentence, if you're speaking a sentence in English, you'll say that in one breath, for example, and then the first kind of sentence in a song, you want to sing it all in one breath, really, and making sure that people aren't like breathing in the middle of words and all that kind of stuff. But I think again, it all comes down to energy as well. Just making sure that you've got your energy up and people are matching your energy level. I don't know, just trying to do some warm ups and things to get people engaging with their body and engaging with their voice and getting ready to sing. And then when you, I think after like a warm up, then once you give them a song, and a lot of these tunes are just very singable. And once you've learned the first verse, you can do all five verses or whatever it is.
That's true.
And especially
They're
with the
all
young
set.
ones, having some actions as well is always quite good. That'll help.
I think as well, I know one of the things is teachers are really nervous about the fact that maybe they feel like they can't sing or that they struggle with doing that. But I have done many a singing lesson. I remember I taught one of my previous classes, like how to harmonize to a song,
Great.
purely because they
Nice.
were a nightmare after break time. If like they'd played football, and so I would bring them all in, and I'd be like, right, we're going to. It was like a Sam Smith, like really bizarre. Like, I was like, we're all just going to sing and harmonize to this, and it's going to be lovely. And it really calmed them,
Oh,
really
that's
calmed them
nice.
down. But I think the kids will think, like 9 times out of 10, they will compliment you and say you're like the best singer in the world. Ask why you've not gone on to X Factor. So, do you know what I mean? Like, they're not listening. They don't think you sound out of tune because they don't, a lot of the time, they're not fully aware of what tune is. Do you know what I mean? If you're singing in time with something, I mean, it depends on their age. When they hit year 6, they aren't as nice, and aren't as, they are a bit more brutal.
Well, I think having singing in as part of the day of school from a really young age is great. I remember hearing like Bruno Mars, "Count on Me" coming through the walls every day at like 3 o'clock or whatever it was, just to finish the day singing a couple of songs. I think it's great. And then just by having that as part of the school day and part of your, it's almost like they're just used to it. So when it gets to like an assembly, it doesn't feel weird that all of a sudden they're just singing a song like once a week.
I actually saw a TikTok the other day that is completely like, you've probably seen it or something along the lines of it. It was a podcast of them talking about music just in the UK in general, just like music as a whole, and how all of these like huge artists will
Oh
say
yeah, I saw this.
the
Yeah, so
UK
I
is
think
like the
someone
best.
tagged me in this video. Yeah.
It's perfect. So the UK like has the best singers, the best like audiences, and the line that the podcast was like, yeah, because we've been doing it all our lives, because we've been like trained in singing assemblies. Like, no one
I have
can
thought
do
that I
that
should
bit.
try and make a video out of that somehow. I'm not sure.
You need to. It's because, and then I told my fiance, and he was like, oh, that's so right. He was like, that's so right. He was like, is that why we're really good at football matches as well? Like, all singing in time. I was like,
I know.
probably,
Yeah.
probably.
And
Like,
they have chanting in other countries and stuff, obviously, but I feel like ours are very, and also actually a lot of the football chants are based on hymns.
yeah, they're based on primary school, like, known songs. I love it. Like, I love it. What is, even though we've all seen the top 10 bangers, if you haven't, you need to go find it in James's channel. What is your favorite primary school banger? Come on, there must be one.
That is a really good question. I mean, obviously I put number one as Shine Jesus Shine. I think that was probably the most iconic for my kind of upbringing, my generation at school.
Mm.
And the funny thing with that one is that a lot of people watched the top 10 and said, I've never heard of number one before.
I don't understand.
But I think it's because it was written in like the late 80s, early 90s. So actually, anyone
Right.
that was in primary school before that just wouldn't really know that one as well. But
True.
I've sung at lots of weddings where their wedding hymn is Shine, Jesus, Shine.
Yeah,
I
100%.
do have a bit of a soft spot for some of the slightly less well-known ones. So there's one which I literally sing pretty much every day in my head when I'm crossing over a road, and it's called Cross Over the Road. I don't know
I've never heard that
if you
one.
ever heard that one.
No.
So yeah, no, that's good. I mean, Give Me All in My Lamp was a classic.
Oh, love that one.
And I also really liked, so there's a guy called Sidney Carter, and he wrote three big bangers. So he wrote One More Step Along the World I Go, and
Banger.
he wrote Lord of the Dance,
Banger.
and he wrote one which was in my top 10 list actually, When I Needed a Neighbor. I don't know if you knew that one. So it's
No.
like, when I needed a neighbor, were you there?
Oh,
Were you there? When I needed
yeah.
a neighbor, were you there? I'll play you a little bit of the Cross Over the Road one, because I just, for me, this was just like a quite a nostalgic one. Oh, another one as well, which was quite nostalgic and less well known, was Thank you, Lord, for this new day. Thank you, Lord, for this new day.
If I
Thank
close
you,
my eyes,
Lord,
I'm back
for
in primary
this new
school.
day, right where we are. And then it went, Hallelujah, praise the Lord. And then everyone had to clap along to,
Love
Praise
it.
the Lord, Hallelujah, praise the Lord. And then the last bit, right where we are. There we go.
It's just like, yeah, just like trans. I feel like that's why your TikTok channel is so loved, though, because if you do close your eyes, you do feel, no matter what age you are, I think you're immediately transported back to primary school. Like, sitting on the year six benches at the back, you know, like loving life, singing along to all the songs. Like I remember hearing your you doing like This Little Light of Mine, which I think is one of my faves.
That's a great one.
I remember it's actually not the best example, but it was the first attention I received
Oh,
because
really?
I was really like in one of my like little mad moods, and anyone that knows me in the chat, and James will as well, I just have like a bit of a bizarre, like I like would, as a teacher, I'd walk around with like microphones, and like I'd need like a little bit of like woo time, and if I didn't get that, I'd go a little bit crazy. And one of them, like at school, you just sometimes don't get that. And I remember I was in a geography lesson, and I loved geography, but I just was not having the best day. And I remember I got kicked out of my class because I stood on a table, sang This Little Light of Mine. I don't recommend it because I got quite a lot of detentions after that. But it was, I loved that song. And when you sang it, I was like, oh my goodness, I'm back at school. I'm back
I think
at
it is
school.
there. I'm sure there's like scientific research about it, but the link between memory and music is amazing, because you can, I get comments like this all the time, and I think about it as well. So I can't remember what I ate for dinner last night, but I can remember every single word to a song which I literally haven't heard since I was like 7 years old.
I remember I went and I, when I was supply teaching before I worked at our school and before COVID, I remember I went into a school and I was supplying and I was there for a day. And one of the things I was there to do was literally just sit in a rehearsal. And I was like, okay, yeah, fine. And it was, they were rehearsing the year six leaving play or something like that. And I sat there and I was listening to the songs and I was like, I really know this. Turned out it was my year six leaving play
Oh,
that
right,
I
okay.
did, and it was exactly the same. And I remember I sat at the back of this school and I wished someone I knew was with me because I couldn't like experience it with anyone. And I just was singing all of the words to every single one of the songs. And it's mad. You remember all of them. Like, it's so bizarre.
We've got a comment from Sonia that says it's a shame that they don't still sing these or play these in school now. And actually, I think it is. Oh yeah, 100%. It's a shame that not every school gets to do singing. It just so happens that the schools that I teach in, they all actually sing in assembly, and they sing these hymns, a lot of them. I was in the music corridor hearing them rehearse the Harvest Samba. Do you
Love
remember that one?
the Harvest
Cab
Samba.
cabbages and greens. That one.
Is that the one? Oh yeah, the cabbages and greens.
Broccoli and beans.
Yes, that.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, it's either that one or what's the other one? Cauliflower stuffing.
Yeah, but I mean, obviously, on a more kind of serious note, there's so many schools in the country where they have zero resources for music and
yeah.
very little money that can be put into buying instruments and things. And actually, when I started the YouTube channel originally, my idea was it'd be good to just put some videos on there that are like tips for music. And if you're a teacher in a school where there aren't really that many resources for it, then you can just whack on a video. Even if it's like the backing tracks, you can just use them. And actually,
yeah.
I don't know if you've seen this actually. I've just put on Spotify. I've put an album out on Spotify.
Love it.
An album on Spotify because why not? Of 16 primary school assembly bangers. And it's just the piano recordings
Love
of
it.
Them. And I've used a piano that is like slightly like school honky-tonk piano type thing. So
yeah.
If anyone's watching and wants to just listen, have a listen. And I was doing something the other day and I was listening through it genuinely to just like check there weren't any mistakes on it.
Mm.
But I listened to it. It's about half an hour long. And it just gives you so many good memories from start
that.
To finish. Because it starts off with Give Me All In My Lamp and you've got Colours of Day. Like you've got Kumbaya. You've got all of the big tunes.
Big classics.
And then someone said that I should do a Christmas what version.
100%.
So have some of the Christmas tunes as well.
100%.
So I'm very much down for that.
100%. I've literally just put up my first decorations in my house today.
Have you?
Much. I've also picked my Christmas tree today. I went and tagged that Christmas tree. I feel like teachers are just like, I don't know whether it's the joy of like looking forward to a holiday.
Yeah.
That you're off or whether it's a genuine because we work with children it also is just like
I've had to get out the Christmas books as well.
Is it?
Yeah. I mean now we're past October, I think it's time, you know.
1st of November, the first thing I put out was the Gavin and Stacey
Step into Christmas. Brilliant, I loved
like,
it.
Like 100%. I do think though, it is such and like my partner is now a TA in a private school. He works in year five. I'm very jealous that he's back in school because I sometimes really miss being in school, particularly this time of year.
Yeah.
And I think music, this time of year, wet play.
Yeah.
Wet play's a nightmare. We can all admit it. What's that sound on TikTok? It's hell in there.
It's
an awful time for any teacher because it's the children don't get that the time that they need to go outside and run around and have that time. But I think music does something, like children love music, having music are always, and the kids that are in this chat that went to our school know, I was asked by particularly one of them, can you just put on music whilst we work, please?
Yeah.
Because all they want is to listen to music. And I think it's a shame, as you were saying, it is a shame that there aren't, you know, there isn't resources for music. It seems to be one of those subjects that is put on the back burner a little bit, which is such a shame because actually, in like, not to sound sappy, but it's one thing that connects every single person and everyone can enjoy it. And I just think it's, if you don't have instruments, if you don't have, you know, when I worked in a school, they had one music lesson and I taught it to all the year fives in one go. So that was 3 form entry. 90 kids had music in one go. They only did singing because the school didn't have any instruments. They had no specialist music teacher. They had nothing. And I taught 90 kids and it was singing. And it was just, even though it's scary for teachers, what you're giving the students is just like such a nice time. So I think, I love the fact that you've recorded and put out a Spotify album because it is what teachers need. They need that, like, that helping hand to like get them started.
Yeah, and what I am going to do when I have the time is to take all of those backing tracks and make like lyric videos for them on YouTube. Mm. So I've done it for two of them, Autumn Days and Cauliflowers Fluffy.
Love it.
But what I'm going to do is, because that is actually probably more useful actually to have that, because then you can teach a song and have the words up on the screen at the same time.
Mm.
But just in terms of like group singing, I found, because I did lots of youth choirs growing up and sang in choirs for ages, from church through to kind of symphony chorus and like national youth choir and stuff. And the thing with singing is that you'll never ever come out of singing, especially group singing, and feel worse than you did when you went into it. Like it's almost impossible because it just engages all. I'm not a scientist, but it engages the right chemicals in your brain. The serotonin, I think, is the right one.
We'll go with that.
Yeah, so it engages all the positivity in your brain. It engages your body. It links you up in terms of doing like a group activity in a way that sport, not that I've got anything against sport at all, but it's you're not against anyone. You're not
It's
doing it
different, isn't
against,
it? It's
you're kind of doing it all together, especially when there's harmonies involved. You're literally building something out of nothing. You're building something out of your person, yourself.
It's so nice. And I think another thing that teachers like I had a really sporty class a couple of years ago. They were really, really sporty, and I would sit, I'd try I'd do singing, and I remember thinking, oh, some of them aren't going to like it. They're not going to like it. It's not their thing. But actually, you start doing it, and you start talking to them about it. And actually, what you'll find is, particularly if you get the right song, so either if it's a song like a primary school banger because they're so catchy and they stay in their head, or if you're nervous about doing something like a primary school banger, but you end up doing something that's on it, like. So I did Sam Smith. I can't remember what song it was, but I did Sam Smith because it had recently just come out. And I remember, like, it was a clean version. There was nothing in it that could be, told off for. And I just found it, and it was actually like such a nice activity. And then if you do are feeling confident and the kids are loving it, then you can be. I remember, like, I bigged it up. I was like, right, we're gonna learn. Like, you're gonna sing this part, and then you're gonna sing the other part. And you were exactly right earlier about what you said about energy. Like, if you give it, like, oh my goodness, this
It is
sounds
hard.
amazing, like, wow, then they're gonna match that and go above it, really, aren't they?
That is hard because it does obviously put a lot of pressure on you as well as a teacher. And then when you've got those days where you're like, do you know what? I've done, this many lessons and I'm knackered. And but you just have to kind of get it out. And I think actually what I've found is that if I'm feeling tired, then just doing a couple of like action warm-ups or something, or a song that involves them, or even if it's just like I had one today where I had a group session and everyone was really tired, and I did a song which was called. It was the Laughing Race, and it was just a silly game, a silly song, really. And I got them to go in pairs, and basically, you kind of have a laugh off. You've got to try. The first person that laughs loses, kind of thing. And then I was singing this song, and then people were joining in. And even though we were all tired, because people started laughing, actually, physically, you're engaging the same muscle that you use for singing, the diaphragm. So that's quite good. And I said, right, get all your laughs out now before we start the game. So everyone starts laughing, ha ha ha, engaging the diaphragm muscle, and then I sing this song and people sing with me, and then it's kind of interactive as well. So that's and then everyone had loads of energy after that. So that's quite a good way to
Love
kind of
that.
get people in. We've got a comment from Izzy that says group singing really does, probably why I do so much of it now. Yeah, I think it's a shame that people, especially our age, don't really sing. I think
No.
maybe like an older generation are more into kind of group singing and joining amateur choirs and things, or semi-professional choirs. But I think that there's definitely a gap in the market. And I was talking about it with a few friends about a month ago, because we got together and sang for a friend's wedding. And we said, it's such a shame that we can't just do this once a week. I know that we've all got busy lives, but I think there's definitely a gap in the market for people in their 20s, 30s, and maybe early 40s for just
It's
getting
just
together once a week and having a
the
sing.
fun.
Yeah,
It's
it is.
just like genuinely good. Even if you don't like singing, you don't think you're very good at it. It's one of those things that it's just, as you said, it's just like it's one of those, just one of those nice things that you get to do, which I guess maybe, it particularly like the jet like this generation isn't like in our generation. I don't think we're the, unfortunately, I don't think we're the same as the generation below us. We can't count ourselves in the same one. But I think it is, something that's like being missed out. And particularly now it's not in schools anymore as much. It's just, it's a bit of it's a bit of like a shame. What, on the topic of like teaching, What's your proudest teacher music moment? Is it like exam results? Because you do, like, I'm guessing, I don't actually know, but I'm guessing you do like you put children forward for their, oh, I do know this actually. I don't know why I've just said that. I know exactly that you put kids forward for their singing exams because I've had children in my class that have come back and said, oh, I've just had my practice one when they've come back from one of your sessions. So, what's like, is that a, is that it, or is there something like completely out there? What's your proudest?
Well, I've got lots of mixed thoughts about exams, to be honest, because I think while they're great as a marker or a milestone for singing lessons, something to work towards, which is always great, I don't really want people to place the be all and end all of their singing lessons as working towards an exam, because then you might get pupils that will say, oh, I only got a merit for this exam, I should have got a distinction, and now I feel like, you know, now I feel really bad because, and it's a shame because while exams can be a great way to get performing experience, some people do get very, not obsessed necessarily, but very much kind of self-critical about it. So in terms of my proudest moments, I would say that even though I have been very proud of certain people getting like distinctions in exams and,
sorry, I'm just reading.
Saw that comment as well.
I'll shout him in a minute, Elodie. I'll tell him to send your mum a message. There you go.
I think, to be honest, some of the proudest moments that I've had have been when I've seen a breakthrough with a pupil. So I've got a piano pupil at the moment who is not on this chat, by the way. So and they were kind of slightly in a rut with their practicing. They didn't enjoy practicing. And we were just doing the same pieces over and over again each week. Mm-hmm. And then something just clicked. And I don't know whether it was a certain lesson that we'd had or whether she just particularly enjoyed the pieces we were doing. But then all of a sudden, just that the self-drive came in. Mm-hmm. And I had to send her mum an email. I said, look, I'm really proud of what she's done. She's gone above and beyond in her practicing. She's improving so quickly because we were going from doing kind of pre-grade one level stuff to kind of advanced, and on, if you have piano lessons, grade one's actually pretty hard.
Yeah,
it is quite, you can, not that I'm dismissing singing grade one, but you can really skip grade singing grade one if you are a good enough singer. But with piano you really do have to go through, like, from the pre-prep, the initial grades, the grade one. So It is hard. So with that, I was really, definitely quite proud.
Oh, that's so lovely. I think sometimes that is it, isn't it? It's like more of the breakthroughs. I think my proudest teaching moments would be my DJ Miss Molly music videos that I made. I just think even though they are so silly, and for what anyone that's, this is very like in, and I'm sure James saw them at school, but if you weren't here when I spoke about it earlier, I was a maths teacher. But one of the things I loved is I love the crossover between maths and music. Like, typically, if you're quite musical, you are quite good at maths. And I am lucky in the fact that I was really understood maths and got it came quite easily. So did music. And I had students at our school, they would sit some really difficult exams. We taught at a private school, and not saying that the SATs exams aren't hard, they are, they're very hard. I think it's the timing of the exams that the children sit at school in most private schools, particularly in London. They have to sit them a lot earlier, so they're a lot younger. So I feel like the pressure is just a lot more. And I remember when I started at the school, I didn't know how I felt about it, because I remember exams being so stressful, and I was thinking, goodness me, they're only like 10 and they're sitting like, in a way, these in one way for them, it's life-changing exams to get them into school. And I was like, how can I make this a little bit more fun? And so I made, as the kids in year six weren't understanding, like changing a fraction to an improper fraction to a like mixed number, they just weren't getting it. And I was like, how can I get them to, like, it's so simple once they understand it, but I couldn't get them to understand it. And I'd done every trick in the book, and I was like, oh, goodness me. And it was becoming like it was such an important part of their maths, like the steps. So I was like, do you know what? I'm gonna film, like, I'll try find. That was it. I was trying to find something on YouTube and there was nothing on that topic. And so I thought, well, I could make something. And so at first I thought I'll just make a rhyme, and I did. And I like rhymed it with them, and they were getting it, but I was like, I really wanted them to remember it. And one of the things I remember from being at school, particularly in like language lessons, so when I had French and German, it was how we were taught things through songs. So I thought, I'm gonna make a song up. I was like, I'm gonna do it. I'll try it, Jim. I'll
And
do
do you know what?
it.
That's hilarious, because that literally just reminded me of something from year nine, where our teacher, biology teacher, was trying to be really cool, and he taught about, I think, osmosis or something, and he used, or I can't, what was it? It was, anyway, whatever it was, he used a Green Day song,
I love that.
and because of at the time, 2004, five, whatever it was, Green Day were really big, and so he's like, oh, you all love Green Day, don't you? So he used a Green Day song, and it was, and sorry, I just went off there.
That's
Phone's gone on low power mode.
fine.
No, and yeah, he used the Green Day song, and we learned through that. But actually, using raps and singing, if I ever did any classroom teaching that was not music, then that would be the way I'd do it. By
I
the way,
just
I just
loved
wanted
it.
to quickly shout out Spicy Holly, if that's your real name, for just sent me a few gifts. So thank you very much,
Yeah, I
Spicy
think she's
Holly.
also sent us some as well, so thank you
Ah.
so much. That's
That's great.
lovely.
Can you still see me okay, by the way? It says
I
it's kind of
can. It's
connecting.
gone slightly darker, but it's still fine. I can see you. It's
Okay,
okay.
all right.
Oh, I've gone darker as well, so it's fine. We'll all just go darker because my light's gone.
Okay.
Yeah, no, 100%. Like, I think as well, as a teacher, you have to do it once, and then you've got, like, that's why I filmed mine. So
Okay.
I ended up making like these stupid music videos to the point in where the first one was a bit rubbish. I just put a glow stick around my head, and then because it did quite well, I did exactly what your science teacher did, and I
Yeah.
thought I was really cool because I was like the young teacher at school, and I was like,
Yeah.
yeah, I'm gonna be that teacher. And so, what song had just come out? Oh, I'm gonna take my heart, that
Yeah.
song. And we, and the students, myself and the students of year six, wrote a song to
Brilliant.
it about something, some maths thing that I can't remember. And then I filmed it in as a music video, but I lived in Croydon at the time. And so I went and like found like a really graffitied
Oh
like
my God.
alley and like
Yeah.
stood there in a huge puff
That's
and shouted
dedication.
it. And I know, and I remember loving it. And I remember it when this was when we also then went on lockdown again. And so I was uploading them to Google Classrooms and I was getting emails from the parents being like, oh, been watching your music video all morning. And I
That's
was like,
brilliant.
oh no, I forgot they can see it. It's not
Have
just.
you ever well, I was going to ask you a couple of questions actually. Who are your favorite kind of education TikTokers? Because obviously there's Tommy TikTok, who you've interviewed.
Tommy TikTok, I mean, just because he's an absolute
He's
darling,
brilliant.
he's brilliant.
He's
You
so
are.
creative, and I don't know how he finds the time to do it.
I know, like, he's full time, still teaches, like, full time, loves it. I think, yeah, definitely Tommy, just because now we know, like, he's probably been in here at some point, but it's really lovely, and we just have a little bit of lovely. And as a teacher myself, as well, I would watch Tommy's TikToks and be like, oh, they're so relatable. You actually always are on my For You page
Oh, really?
or on Twinkles. In fact, I was in a meeting with some other Twinkl workers from other segments, and I was like, oh, I'm interviewing James Partridge later, and they were like, we love him. And I was like, fun
Oh, that's
fact,
nice.
worked at school with him. I know the celebrity himself. Is it Kit as well?
Oh,
Kit Brown.
He's
He's
brilliant.
someone we're trying to get on. So if everyone go comment on Kit's stuff. We really want Kit to come on our TikTok. I think it's Kit. If it's not Kit, then I'm really embarrassed. But his name's Mr. Brown. Works in a year four classroom, but also plays football, which is, I think, another, like, it's a fun, like, teacher fact. But yeah, I just. Do you know what? There's loads of people, and we've had some great ambassadors as well. We've had Teresa, mid-sized Teresa, Fun in Year Five, Miss J Primary, all of them. Like, I love teachers that are still teaching and not now become influencers, because I think it's just there's a understanding of like what it's really like. And I think, you know, the classroom changes so quickly. I think they're my favorite. I've never been asked some questions. It's quite nice.
Yeah, I think Mr. PICT is a bit of a legend as well.
Of course, he's just a legend, isn't he?
Yeah.
I've actually filmed a video today that's going to go out on Sunday. And it's basically me pretending to be a lot of different teaching influencers. You are one of them.
Oh, really?
But there's a lot of them for particular TV show that's going out on Sunday evening. Some people in the comments, I'm sure, are going to know exactly what TV show is coming out on Sunday. But it's a very popular ITV TV show.
Right.
Don't want to give too much away, but I'm basically being the rendition of a couple of teachers and very excited about it to come out. So if you're after that video and you're in here and you think, oh, what does Molly actually think James is like? Go follow Twinkl Stage 2, because you'll get to see it.
my phone's on about 10%, so I've probably got another 10 minutes or so. So I don't know if you want to...
Do we want to do some tunes? Do some tunes? Right.
Some people have possibly been waiting very patiently.
Really, they're all here for you, James.
I don't know about that.
Basically see your beautiful piano. In fact, my manager's just popped in the chat. I've just seen his name. And I know he will love to hear the piano. When I said you were going to bring the piano and pop on some renditions. I want to be transported back to primary school, James.
Okay.
I'm going to try guess some songs.
So are you... Shall I give you a quiz? Or are you going to give me a quiz?
Well, I've got some. So I don't know whether you want to... Because people have been here for you, waiting to hear you...
Okay.
Do some renditions. Do you want to start it? And I've got some waiting as well. Mine are not as good as James's because they're on YouTube. I'm not playing them.
All right, I'll play you one which I actually posted earlier today, which I won't tell you what the name of it is, but I don't know. I'll be interested to know if you sang this. We used to sing this all the time, so this was a banger. Somehow, unbelievably, someone has literally commented what it is before I've even played one. I think I might have played one note. Anyway, so here we go. That's a super fan there. Have you heard the raindrops drumming on the rooftops? Have you heard the raindrops dripping on the ground? Have you heard the raindrops splashing in the streams and running to the rivers all around? There's water of life.
That's
Jesus kiss. Yeah, so give me the title there. At the water of life, there's water of life. Jesus gives us the water of life.
So I feel like as soon as you sang the chorus, I knew exactly what you were doing.
Yeah,
beforehand,
yeah.
I was a bit like, you know when you think you know a song, but it could be something else.
Yeah.
But no, the chorus, that's another banger. There are so many.
It is, yeah.
Where is it? I'm going to... popular... Where is the... So I would sometimes listen to this exact playlist with my fiance, and we'd literally be like, I remember that song. Just like, love it. So this is, if you were... This is a bit later on.
Okay. Okay.
Okay. So this might not be a banger.
Okay.
But do you remember this one?
Wake up, shake up.
There we go.
Straight away.
There he is. He's got it.
Get your body moving. Reach up, stand up. Give your friend the thumbs up.
Another new day. Oh, I love it. Oh, you're quick. You knew that before like even singing started.
Yeah. Get your feet dancing to the beat. Get your body moving. Jump and shout. Da 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 da. It's another new day. Anyway, yeah,
there we go.
Big... No, that is... that. I would arguably describe that as a modern day banger.
modern day. Yes, you're right. It's more of a
Yeah.
modern. It's like one that's fit. Like you can like find the lyric video online. Like it's there. It's ready.
Yeah.
It's waiting. I now this was one that I had to show you. Oh, let me just mute this little advert. There was one that I actually played this character in the Easter performance. So you're gonna know what it is. I've already nearly given it away. Come on.
Spring chicken.
There we go. Sorry, can we just all, everyone in the chat? James just got that from do spring chicken, like spring chicken. What a song!
It's a big
What a
one.
song!
So that's one I didn't know from growing up. So we never sang that one growing up. It's just that more recently I've heard it. It's actually just been from people commenting on my video saying spring chicken, spring chicken, spring chicken.
Do you like when people comment, are you like literally on YouTube being like, what is it? Like, have you had a song that you can't find?
Oh yeah, for sure. So it's actually recently been on Instagram, on Reels. It's just started kicking off a bit. And so I've got quite a lot of new followers on there, which is great. But then that's meant a lot of people have messaged me saying, I remember this song, like, please can you play it? It has this lyric and it has like one random line. I'm like, that's I don't know what that is. There's one song that's been really bugging me. I've been trying to find it. It's about otters. It's like a song about otters. And I've Googled it. I can't find. I found
Is
like
it
some
more
random.
modern
I
or is
don't
it?
know. This is from like the 80s and 90s. So I found like a random chat room of the student room from like going back to 2007 where someone said, does anyone remember this song? But apart from that, I can't find any information about it online whatsoever. So I think part of the appeal of these videos is that actually there isn't really much about
No.
them online. It's more it is just living in our memories. So
Yeah, which I think is it's lovely, but it also is so nice to unlock them. I think particularly like when you're like, I mean, like I'm mid-20s and I know I'm one of the like the younger teachers, but particularly being a teacher and like looking back and being like, oh, I remember that, like I remember doing these songs at school and I really loved them. And so I think it's nice to unlock those memories. It's a shame. It feels like there needs to be like a website somewhere with every single primary school song that you would
Well,
have ever sung.
or a Spotify
Or a spot,
playlist, you know.
or if not a Spotify playlist, go find James's YouTube, because if you type in one thing that I've really struggled with is I've typed in on YouTube popular primary school bangers and every video that comes up is one of James's.
There we go.
The
We've got
top
the niche. That's the niche in the market there.
five.
I didn't really think when I set up my YouTube and TikTok accounts that like the majority of my videos would be primary school songs, but it brings me a lot of happiness and nostalgia. And by the way, I've been reliably informed that it is dopamine that gets released
There we
when you
go.
sing. So there we go.
I sing the songs I sang in school to the toddlers I work with. Yeah,
That's also
exactly.
really nice. And a lot of parents sing them to their kids. So to be honest, like recently, I've had so many incredibly nice messages on Instagram. I had one from someone that said that they were in a car accident and they lost their memory. Like this was years ago, and they lost, like they can't remember the first 15 years of their life or whatever. And they said through one of my songs, they got like some memories of singing in school, and that's absolutely just like mind blowing.
I love that. That's like such a lovely, but that's what music can do. And I think that's why if you are a teacher and you're in this chat and you are like, I steer clear when music's on my timetable and I see it's there, I will do anything to avoid that lesson because you're embarrassed about it or you're not confident. Children will not be Simon Cowell. They're not going to be the X Factor judges. And I think it's so important. Like Twinkl, we have loads of resources. And I did see a comment earlier, and I don't know if you're still in, but I saw something like Twinkl's not been working for you at work. That's really bizarre. I haven't heard anything through Twinkl that anything's been down. But if there is, and you're at work and you can't find something, that's the beauty of, that's why we have all these social media. So if you're a Key Stage 2 teacher and you can't find a particular music resource, it might be because it's not been made, by Twinkl. However, if you message us and you're like, do you know what? I'm doing a thing on, I don't know, spring chickens or whatever. And I really want to find some like music related resources. Message us because that's how we make resources. All of the people who work for Twinkl have worked in a school themselves, whether they've been a teacher. So all of us at Key Stage 2, we have all been, or we still are, teachers. A lot of us are still teachers in a school, still teaching Key Stage 2. And so if you message us and are like, oh, I need a resource on this, we can send it to the people that can make those resources. So yes.
Chloe's just said that she thought her teachers were amazing singers, so that
There you go. Like
that's it.
that's it. If
And
I
probably,
remember
amazing
my,
piano players and things.
yeah, like I remember I think I told my music teacher that he should go on X Factor. He didn't, thank goodness. But like I remember being like, wow, you're so good.
So I think my phone is actually about to die very imminently. So I could happily sit and chat for another
I
hour, to be
know.
honest. But so that maybe we need a part two of this. We need
I
to do
feel
a
like
part
we
two.
definitely do.
Yeah,
We
'cause there's a lot we haven't
have,
covered, I think.
I know, we've got a bit of a teacher like Olympics going on at the moment, I feel like it is, with some of these lovely teacher influencers. So we need to get you on with someone like someone else, and we need to get you to battle each other with the primary curriculum. We'll stick some music questions in there for you.
I love
Fab, it
it.
was so lovely to speak to you, James.
Yeah, you
Fun
too.
fact, but also just to see a good old friend.
I know,
Really
absolutely.
lovely.
I feel like I should end on a song
Go on then.
just to go. So let's do One More Step Along the World I Go, just to kind of see it out,
Oh,
you know.
love it.
Okay, so you can sing along if you want to. If you're
Yeah.
watching this, feel free. I'm sure it'll be beautiful. So here we go. One more step along the world I go. One more step along the world I go. From the old things to the new. Keep me traveling along with you. And it's from the old I travel to the new. Keep me traveling along with you. There we
Oh,
go.
well done, Mr. James. That was amazing.
Thank you very
Thank you
much.
so much for joining
I
us.
like
It was
dancing.
lovely having you. Yeah, like my little cheering, like my cheerleader.
I'll give
And
you
yeah.
the harvest samba.
Yeah, like me with my that's one of my favourite
Yeah.
songs. Though I'm like even the, oh look, I've got the pumpkins in the background, I'm so ready.
There we go.
Ah, well, it was lovely having you on. It was lovely talking to you. Thank you, everyone
Thanks so
who's
much.
stuck
Yes.
around.
Thank you so much for everyone that's joined
I
and
know.
watched this live. It's been fantastic. Hope you've
It's been
got something
lovely.
out of it, if not just killing an hour watching us ramble about stuff.
Exactly. Okay, well, it was lovely talking to you, and I'm sure
Yeah,
we'll speak
let's
again.
do a part two soon, for
Part
sure.
two. We'll pop it in
Yeah.
the diary.
Yeah. Sounds good.
See you
Thanks so
later.
much. See you later.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.
Bye.